Hey guys, welcome back to another episode. Now, in the last episode, we implemented the create post functionality, and we're also able to fetch all posts from the database and display it on the manage posts page. Now, before we proceed with this episode, I just want to clarify something from the last episode. So at present, any user that is logged in is able to create a post, but by the time we finish this project, that is not going to be the case. So if you see me just logging in with any user that is not even an admin user and being able to create a post, that is not actually a bug. It's not a mistake. It is just because we are still in development mode and we haven't yet finished all the features. So by the time we finish all the features, only the admin users will have access to create posts and manage posts and all the other functionalities of the admin dashboard. So for now, when you see some of these things, they are not actually a bug. We are going to implement them very soon. Okay, so having gotten that out of the way, we'll go back to what we are going to do in this video. Now in this episode, we are going to implement form validation on our create post functionality. So if the user clicks on the add post button without filling out the form, it's going to create an empty post in our database and we don't want that. So let's fix it. If you go to our code base and open to the post.php file inside the controllers folder, we'll see the section of our code that receives the values from the form and creates a new post in our database. So what we need to do is to validate the values from the input from the form before creating our post. Now in the previous video, we created a file called validatepost.php inside the helpers folder. So if we open the helpers folder, we'll see that file here. So inside this file, we're going to write our function to validate a post. This function is going to look a lot similar to what we have inside our validateUser.php file. So let's just copy the validateUser function and we paste it inside our validatePost.php file. And of course, we change the name of the function to validatePost. And this function is going to be validating posts, not user. So we're going to change the name of this parameter to post, and the values we are going to be validating are the post title, the body of the post, the topic, and the image. So the first thing here is, if the user doesn't provide a title, we'll just say title is required. If they don't provide the body, we'll say body is required. And if they don't provide a topic ID, we just say please select a topic. Okay, so that's it for validating the input fields. We have not validated the image now. I left that out intentionally because we are going to validate it when we are implementing image upload on the post form. Okay, now we are going to implement unique post validation, and this ensures that no two posts in our database has the same title. So we'll select from our post table in the database where the title is the same as the title that the user is providing. If we find such a post, we'll refer to it as an existing post, and if that post exists, we'll say post with that title already exists. And with this, we are done with our validate post function. So let's head back to our posts.php in the controllers folder. So before anything else, we need to validate our posts. So we'll call our validate post function and pass it all the post values from the create post form. The validate post function returns an array of errors, so we will check and ensure that that errors array doesn't have any errors in it. So if errors array is equal to 0, if the number of entries inside the errors array is equal to 0, that is the only time when we can create our post. Else, what are we going to do if there are errors in the errors array? We'll just keep the form. We'll just make sure the form remains in place, and all the data that was provided in that form will remain on the form so that the user can just edit it instead of filling the form all over again. So we are going to set these variables so that we can put them back on the form if the user did not enter valid values. Now, of course, these values are inside an if statement, so we can't use them on the form yet because they won't be defined. If we use them on the form now, we are going to see an undefined error. So what we need to do is initialize these variables outside of the if statement so that they become available globally and we can use them on our form. And of course, we'll give them an initial value of empty string so that when this page first of all renders, the form will be empty until when the user has entered some values and submitted the form with invalid data before we can give values to these variables. And these values now will be displayed on our form. So let's display them. We'll start with the title and then the body, and lastly the topic, which is going to be a little bit complicated, complex. So what we need to do is we need to first of all check, we'll use an if else statement, and we'll first of all check if the variable topic ID is not empty, which means that the user selected it before. And we'll also check if the topic they selected is the same as this particular topic in the topic array that we are looping over. The error statement here is supposed to be a colon and not a semicolon. Okay, so if the topic was selected before and that particular topic is this current topic in the loop, then we should display this option and mark it as selected. Otherwise, that is the else part of the if else statement, we are just going to display this particular topic, but we are not going to mark it as selected. Okay, now this is our form. We are performing validation, but when you click on the add post button, it doesn't submit the form, but it doesn't display error messages either. And that is because we are not writing the part of our code that is responsible for displaying errors, and we need to add that part here. And now, as you may remember, we had created a form errors file inside our helpers folder, and this errors file is responsible for checking if there are any errors and then looping over those errors and displaying them line by line. So all we need to do to display our errors here is to include this file. So we use our root path variable to get to the root folder of the application, then we enter the app folder and then the helpers folder where we have our form errors.php file. So this is enough to display our validation messages. So if we click on add post, it's not going to work. If we select a title and we click on add post, the title remains on our form. Even the topic that we select will remain on our form if our post is not valid. And then if you enter a title that already exists, it's going to say the post with that title already exists. So now let's enter the right values and maybe an image, even though it's not being image upload hasn't been implemented yet. When we click add post, it's going to create our new post in the database. So our validation is now working. So there are a few tiny modifications that we need to do on this form. First of all, we need to add a publish field, which is just going to be a checkbox which the user would check if they want the post article they are creating to be published, or if they leave it unchecked, it means it will not be published. Secondly, on the manage post page, when we create a post and we are taken to this page, there is no flash message informing us that our post was successfully created. So let's add these two things, beginning with the publish checkbox in the add post form. So if you scroll down to the bottom of the form, just above the div element that is enclosing the add post button, we are going to create a div element, and inside that element we'll have a label, and that label will be for the published or checkbox. So we'll have an input of type checkbox, and the name will be published. We'll not give it any ID, and let's just add a text here called published or publish, so that the user can know that it's an option to publish the article. So with this, if you go to our form and refresh, we see that our publish field is already here. Okay, so now let's implement the functionality for this publish. So the name field, the name for this input field is published. If you go to the controller, we are expected to see something like published inside the post variable. Now here we were setting it to 1 because we were not sending it initially. So we just wanted some kind of a placeholder to hold it in the meantime, because we needed to indicate it in our database. That's why we're putting 1. But now we are actually sending the published value from our form. This is it. So all we need to do is we need to check if the user has selected the published field, then it means that they want it to be published. In that case, it will be 1. Remember, 1 is boolean, which means true in MySQL. And the other option is the else clause, which means that if they did not select, we're just going to set the published value to 0. So this is just a shorthand form of an if-else statement. If this statement is true, that is, if the user selected the published field, then the published attribute should be set to 1, which is true. Otherwise, it should be set to false, which is 0. So with that, we are already setting our published field. Okay, the next thing now is to set some session variables that will hold some kind of messages that will be displayed on our manage posts page. So what we need to do is, after creating the post, we are going to set some session messages. We will say post created successfully, and the second session object is the type of the message, which is going to be a success message. So we'll just give it the string success. Okay, now inside our index.php file, we are going to display our message, and we have already created an includes file here. that will display our messages. So all we need to do inside our manage post page is to include this file, because this file, all it does is it displays, it checks if we have messages in our session, and then if there is any message, it will display it. So we're just going to call this file again. We can use our root path constant. It will take us to the root, and then we'll enter the app folder. And then inside the app folder, we'll go to the includes and then messages.php. Okay, so with this, I'm sure that we are done with the small changes I was talking about. So let's try them out. Let's select publish now. Oh, you know what? Before now, all the posts I've been creating have been with value 1 for publish. So I'm not going to publish this one. And when I click add post, you see that a message is displayed here saying that post successfully created. And because this particular post was not published, we now have the option to publish it. Okay, and we go to our database. If we refresh, we're going to see now that this particular post has 0. Now there is one little thing that I want us to address before I conclude this, and that is these tags that we see inside our database. Whenever you see tags like HTML tags inside your database, that is a bad sign, because it means that your code is vulnerable to a certain kind of attack called cross-site scripting. So if you want to look more into this kind of attack, you can just do a quick Google search. But for now, just know that putting HTML tags inside your database is very, very insecure. It's very, very unsafe. So we are just going to fix this a very simple way. Now here, our post variable has the body of our post, and it is that body that we want to remove the tags. So here, right before we create our post, we are going to set a new value for the body of the post. And this value is going to be, let me just copy this. This new value is going to be the value, the same value that the user provided, but we are going to modify it a bit. So we will wrap it around a function called HTML entities. Okay, so what this does is it takes these tags and transforms them into a certain format. You know what, let me just create one. Okay, so let me select a topic and then we add the post. Now if we go to our database and refresh, you're going to see now that we have some kind of ampersand, less than, and greater than signs to represent these tags. So our code from now on is going to be more secure. So if you read about XSS cross-site scripting, unfortunately I'm not connected. So if you read more about this, you're going to know why this is more secure. Okay guys, so that is it for this episode. Thank you guys for watching, and hopefully we'll see you in the next episode.